Hello and welcome to the second webinar of the Georgetown Global Dialogues. With me are two brilliant commentators on international affairs, Nesrine Malik and Zhang Lijia. And we'll be talking about the global histories of feminism. We're going to talk for about 45 minutes or so, and then we're going to take some questions. Anyone who wants to pose a question or even a comment can do so using the Q&A icon at the bottom of their screens. I think the reason why we chose to talk about the global histories of feminism is because we are going to be discussing, very simply, the futures of feminism in the at the global dialogues in late April. And we thought, before we actually get to talking about its potential, about its possibilities in a very fraught global context, let's try and explore the larger interconnected history of feminism in not only a Western context, but also in large parts of the world where it has been identified, rightly or wrongly, as a Western ideal. And I think it's possible perhaps that exploring further the long, very complicated histories of feminism in Asia, Africa, Latin America would bring us to a broader understanding of what feminism consists of, what its possibilities are, what its achievements are, and also what its failures have been historically. I mean, I think we're all struck by how feminism now seems yet another universalist ideal that has been tainted by its complicity with, well, humanitarian wars, with various ideological crusades. I mean, I suppose the worst example of that is the feminism of a figure like, a corporate figure like Sheryl Sandberg, who I remember, in 2013, publishing a book called Lean In. And in the very next year, welcoming heartily Mr. Narendra Modi, the Prime Minister of India, to Silicon Valley, and saying how honored she was to receive this figure who, as we know, has been connected to, even responsible for a sort of massive crackdown on women's rights in his home state in Gujarat and in other parts of India. And that's only one example of just how selective this kind of feminism has been. So I think my question to my fellow panelists, at least the first question really, is to what extent is feminism tainted by this association with a very Western project, which is of, taking control of systems without actually challenging inherent inequality, inherent injustices in those systems? And is it possible to rescue this essential ideal of women's equality, women's rights, from this particularly tainted source? So I'm going to turn to Lijia here and ask her about the particular history of feminism in China. I mean, in many ways, I think in most parts of Asia and Africa, from the 19th century onwards, there is a very strong focus on women's rights for a variety of reasons, which we'll go into later. But China seems a very interesting example of, there being a very, very strongly patriarchal system. Mm-hmm. And by the end of the 19th century, there are challenges emerging to it from various parts of a modernizing society. And of course, in the early 20th century, the cause is taken up by sort of, the Communist Party of China. So could you tell us a little bit about, the sort of particular trajectory of feminism in China, Lijia?
Sure. And I think you raised a very interesting question, talking about feminist movement, people in the West, often take what people in the world often take a Western perspective. For example, if you Google history of feminism, you will learn the three or four waves of feminist movement, and only focusing on the West, in particularly white middle-class Western women. However, gender equality is really a global issue, and outstanding non-Western women have fought bravely and made a great contribution. Feminism in China has started in the beginning of 20th century. I'm just finishing a historical novel inspired by China's first feminist woman called Qiu Jing, and she was also a very renowned revolutionary martyr. She was born in the end of the 19th century, and she was in 1907, 4 years before the dawn of the Qing, China's last dynasty. She was beheaded for trying to overthrow the Qing dynasty. And back then, you know, women were supposed to stay at home, but she played a public role. She ran a school to train insurgents, hoping to overthrow the Qing dynasty. And she was a very large than life character. She cross-dressed, she drank like a fish, she was into bomb making, she was into the horse riding. And she was a victim of, she was had bonded feet, she had arranged marriage. So she called for the public education women, called abolition of the cruel practice of foot binding. And she even attacked Confucius ideology, which regarded women, and Confucius regarded women as inferior. I think a children's story challenged the sole ownership of Westerners fighting for gender equality. Pankaj, about 10 years ago, you wrote a book about the ruins of the empire, looking at Asian intellectuals that made an impact on history. So I like the book very much. For one thing, it is not Western centric, as many of such books are. So you set a good example, Pankaj. So, and I think we need more books about more non-Western feminist.
One of the omissions in that book was the role played, although the timeline didn't fit, but there were very strong women activists in places like Indonesia, for instance. There was someone who pioneered female education in Indonesia, a woman called Kartini, who used to write for the papers of Dutch colonialists, but also had a very kind of sharp political critique of Dutch colonialism. There was an Indian woman called Pandit Ramabai who had a massive influence across Asia and Africa starting the late 19th century. So there are quite a lot of historical figures from that period. I was born in a town called Jhansi and spent much of my early life there. And the place is famous all across India for the person we used to call Rani of Jhansi, the Queen of Jhansi, who led a memorable battle against British imperialists in the 1857 mutiny. So I sort of grew up surrounded by this particular historical legend of an incredibly brave woman who took on the British on horseback. And it's interesting how these histories are quite sort of weirdly recessed within the larger histories, of Asia and Africa, and how, there's so much work needs to be done. I'm going to turn to Nesrine and ask her what her particular sort of historical awareness of this particular role played by women in politics and society at large has been.
Well, what's curious for me, I come from Sudan, and I grew up in the Middle East and North Africa, so primarily in Muslim conservative countries. And I had not encountered a kind of Western definition of what feminism was. until sort of early adulthood. And what I found interesting upon encountering it is that, as you say, the history of all feminism has collapsed into this kind of linear Western journey that has milestones. So right to divorce, right to universal suffrage, business ownership, etc. And then the recent iteration, which is the right to lean in and the right to accumulate capital, both social and material, in a way that is equal to men. And what I found curious about this collapsed history was that it didn't factor the fact that a bunch of these rights had been awarded in kind of interesting and counterintuitive ways to women in places that they would consider completely in the dark ages. So in Islam, which is a religion that is popularly traduced as misogynistic, and where sort of two, three popular aspects of it are constantly rolled out, the fact that women, you know, women's right to witness in court is worth half of a man's, that inheritance is not distributed equally between men and women, etc., is subordinated to the fact that 1500 years ago, women were given the right to divorce. Women were given the right, just even before sort of official legislature was established in the Arabian Peninsula. So it's customary law, the right to divorce, the right to reject your husband's sexual advances, the right to universal suffrage in the kind of informal way that it was arranged at the time, the right to own businesses, the right to run your own economic fate. These were all things that strangely had become entirely subsumed under sort of two, three aspects of jurisprudence when it comes to women in Islam that just seemed very interesting to me, that these, like, there was no kind of curiosity or interrogation of how in such quote unquote backward cultures, things that you've had to fight very hard for in the 20th, as recently as the 20th century, in some places had been won already, and why that was the case, and why it looks the way it is. The second thing that I find quite interesting and jarring is that there is a discourse around Western feminism that seems to assume that the fight for feminist or women's rights is linear, against all evidence, actually, to the contrary, that once something has been secured, then it's secured forever. And actually, that's not the case. And we've seen evidence of that even in the past two, 3 years in the US with the reverse of Roe versus Wade. You know, women's rights are things like all rights, actually, that are always negotiable and subject to whatever the health of the political environment is at the time. And when those rights are rolled back, there is still no reflection on why it's so easy to roll them back, right? There's no understanding of how rights become embedded, and how they become, on how their roots become shallow. Similarly, there is an analog to that in kind of Muslim feminist history, which is as these early rights were established, they then became purloined and monopolized by upper classes, essentially. So there is a similarity there that also I feel like people don't quite pay attention to, that there is a lot of leeway in these ostensibly backward cultures for women from certain classes, in a way that actually entirely mimics men's rights. So the higher up the chain you go, the more your rights look like a man's right, in the Arab and Muslim world. And it would be very useful, actually, to try and compare and contrast the class elements and the power elements of how women's rights become untouchable and enshrined, and how they become easily rolled back. And the third thing I would say as well, in kind of upon encountering Western feminist history, is that it seems divorced entirely from how everyone is struggling under the patriarchy, right? So during the Arab Spring, it was very focusing to see all these kinds of rights jostle for space when there was this space for freedom, no matter how small it was, 10 years ago. So there was, you know, people, women coming with their questions and concerns about women's rights, men coming with their questions and concerns about incarceration, employment, all sorts of stuff. And it was quite a clarifying moment that actually an environment in which women's rights are fragile or constantly contested is an environment in which everyone's rights are fragile and constantly contested. It might look different. You know, the fact that women cannot vote or could not drive until recently in Saudi Arabia did not mean that the men were having a great time. You know, the men were being incarcerated without trial. They were being, especially young men, young teenagers, were primarily the targets of the religious police and anti-terrorism legislation, kind of the politicizing of all sorts of social and economic discontents in a country that abides none of it. And it feels like it's much easier to make those connections in societies where civil rights broadly are quite fragile, that you can see how everyone under a patriarchal system essentially functions under an authoritarian system. And no one wins really, except people right at the top of the pyramid. And I find that something quite useful for people to try and get their heads around when it comes to Western feminist discourse, because it is seen as a competition between men and women, that men are fine and that women need to now secure their sexual freedom, rights from sexual harassment, rights to sit on boardrooms, etc. But there is no understanding of how a society, on the one hand, can diminish the rights of one party and enshrine the rights of another. It's actually just not possible, because it's an entire ecosystem of rights withholding and bargaining. So there is no understanding, or there is no or very little discussion of women's rights or lack thereof as an extension of the diminishment of men's rights as well in several ways, and as an extension in general of functioning under a kind of pseudo patriarchal capitalist system in which these rights cost money, right? So offering childcare for women costs money, offering paternity leave for men costs money, pitting them against each other so that women try and kind of grab whatever they can to have a viable working existence under a capitalist system means constantly kind of accumulating or taking away as much as possible from men. But there's just no discussion of how it's one rights ecosystem. And it feels to me like it's easier in a culture, I'll just end on this, it feels like it's easier in a culture where civil rights are very visibly curtailed for everyone, for you to make the connection between men and women, as opposed to one where there is a kind of semblance or a sensation of kind of post-civil rights acquisition.
That's fascinating. Or you have a situation where rights of different minorities are jostling with each other for recognition. And it's a very conscious decision is taken to underprivilege certain people's rights over the rights of, I mean, I'm thinking of actually this famous quote from, you know, great icon of American feminism, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, mm-hmm. who wrote in 1865, you know, now as the celestial gate to civil rights is slowly moving on its hinges, it becomes a serious question whether we had better stand aside and see Sambo walk into the kingdom first. So this, you know, again, the sort of idea that there are these particular rights that are going to be on offer, but I think it's best to, you know, seize them for ourselves before someone else sort of gets to them, you know, which I suppose is a historical flaw or defect that has stayed with that kind of model of feminism. Lijia, I want to turn to you and ask you, I mean, in China, where at least, you know, you don't have problem that arises where you have incredible multi-ethnic, multi-religious diversity. But at the same time, we've seen that, I mean, especially when you look at early 20th century and the movements for gender equality and the sort of, you know, I suppose the whole idea, Chairman Mao putting out the idea that women hold up half the sky. And so we need to include them in our revolutionary program. And of course, mm-hmm. you know, we see also some big gains in the late 40s, early 50s, all kinds of, you know, oppressive, barbaric practices are outlawed. Mm-hmm. But there is a sense that, you know, this is being done so that women can become productive members of this new society that mm-hmm. is that is coming into being. How would you rate that particular phase, you know, in sort of early sovereign China to the yeah. present? I know you wrote a piece very recently in the Financial Times about, you know, representation of women at the highest mm-hmm. levels of mm-hmm. The Chinese political class mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. how that is still at pretty abysmal levels.
Yeah, perhaps I can use the story of my family to tell the how the role of women have changed in China. So my grandmother, who was a very special person, she was born in 1911, and she became an orphan at a young age, and then she was sold by her uncle to a brothel. My grandmother was a prostitute. And then she met my grandfather on the job, and he took her as a concubine. So my grandmother lived a miserable life until Chairman Mao ordered them, took over power in 1949. The Chinese Communist Party took over, and Chairman Mao ordered the men to have one wife. So my grandfather then got rid of his wife, married to his sweet-natured concubine. So perhaps for this reason, my grandmother was very grateful to Chairman Mao. She loved Chairman Mao. Also, my grandmother was illiterate. You know, in 1949, something like 10% of women were literate. So the Communist Party organized this kind of anti-literacy campaign. So my grandmother learned a few basic numeracy, and also she learned how to write her name. that was my grandmother always loved Chairman Mao. And my mother fared better. She became a factory worker, and in fact, she worked all her life for state-owned enterprise. So I guess I have to say that I think the Chinese Communist Party did a lot for women. One of the first law the Chinese Communist Party erected was the 1950s marriage law. It was not just about marriage, but also banned the feudal practice of food binding, concubine keeping, and allowed women to inherit, allowed women to have education and employment. So those are extremely important movement progress. And then of course the women were encouraged to take jobs. So my mother became a factory worker, and also that was, you know, it is progress, but also. China was in a mess, so they need a woman as a labor. My mother worked all her life at a factory, and basically a men's job, an ASIC pickling machines, putting in a chemical compound, being pickled. It was really a men's job. But Chairman Mao's idea of gender equality was to deny the physical difference between men and women. And then we have the reform and the opening up, which granted unprecedented opportunity for both men and women. But one, sadly, and I think one factor was not so well known is that reform and opening up led to the gender pay gap widened the gender pay gap, because the government retreated some of the responsibility to let the market take over. But the market has never treated the woman kindly. And then China kind of, you know, this always kind of goes up and down, sometimes with control, sometimes relaxation. But after Xi Jinping took over power, everything was all tightened up. For example, in 2015, on the International Women's Day, or the day before, five feminists were arrested. And before that crackdown, from 1912, China actually saw the feminist activism started in China. And in 2012, on Valentine's Day, three of my friends went to the street, put on wedding gown, splattered with fake blood, to protest against domestic violence. But after Xi Jinping took power, he had a crackdown. Some of the NGOs were shut down. Sorry, I forgot one important point. It was 1995, the fourth International Women's Conference was held in China. That really had a monumental influence in China. So ever since then, the new feminist ideas were introduced, some books were translated, and NGOs, women's NGOs started. And if without the crackdown led by Xi Jinping, there would have been a real feminist movement. But now there's still online feminism, there's still daily feminism. For example, one of the some feminist influencers encourage women, for example, do not obey your family, live for yourself, be selfish if necessary. If you don't want to have children, don't have children. So there are kind of daily feminism, online feminism, but a feminist as a movement in China is not happening anymore, sadly.
That's interesting. She's reminding me of, Ibsen's drama play, A Doll's House, was a huge hit. I mean, people talk about its European reception and how influential it was in Europe and America, but it was very big in large parts of Asia. And the Chinese writer Lu Xun, who know better than I do, Lijia, didn't he write a story, I think, what happens to Nora after she leaves, she leaves the house? And he says, if there isn't a corresponding reform, which, a point that connects to what Nesrine just made, in other social structures, in a corresponding improvement of rights for the entire population, Nora is going to end up in a Chinese context becoming a prostitute once she leaves home, once she decides to strike out on her own, because there are so few opportunities really for anyone, let alone someone who leaves home. But I mean, your account of the Chinese journey seems to suggest that a state-led project of nation building, paradoxically, and especially a communist one, created more opportunities for women during that period than, say, a more free market driven capitalist model, where, as you said, the market has not been particularly kind to women. And of course, now, the problems of neoliberal capitalism are especially acute for women, whether it's underpaid care work or wage gaps, racialized gender violence or you know, labor market segregation. And you know, again, a whole lot of these things are not particularly well addressed by mainstream sort of feminist movements in the West. Nesrine, I mean, how do you explain? I mean, do you think this is, there is something inherent in the structures that we now live in, the economic structures that we live in, that make for these, that make these disparities more and more entrenched?
I think, yes, in a word, but I think there is also that the right questions sometimes are not being asked about such economic disparities. And I find that the kind of parameters of what we are told to assume as like the model of feminism. So, you know, closing the wage gap, freedom to choose your partner, freedom to travel, freedom, all these ways that mimic men's rights, do not seem to ask what is freedom, right? What is, and feminism seems to kind of have become stovepiped away from the question of what is freedom. It started out, as all these movements do, as a liberation movement, but seems to have become completely shorn of the question of what freedom entails. And the result of that is overemphasizing kind of social freedoms, right? Emphasizing cosmetic freedoms, the visibility of women, which is like a particular fixation in Western cultures, their ability to choose their lifestyles. All of these things have become overemphasized at the expense of the question about whether they feel really free. And that question kicks in properly when women have children, or when they need to consider sort of marriage, property, relocation, every time they enter a social construct based on their biology and their partnership in a heteronormative way, those questions of freedom suddenly kick in, but people don't think about them in terms of freedom. They think about them in terms of resourcing, right? In terms of competitive resourcing with partners. You know, men don't do enough, they don't clean up, they don't help women, women are frustrated in their marriages, et cetera. As opposed to, does this kind of feminist Valhalla that you've created actually mean women are free? And the corollary of that, as someone who kind of straddles both cultures now, is that, just to do my own little vignette about my background. So both my grandmothers were also barely literate, but really quite counterintuitively had a lot more social freedom than their daughters and their granddaughters. So they were able to drink alcohol. They were able to kind of trade. This is very specific microclimate in Sudan, so I don't want anyone to think I'm generalizing. This kind of northern tribal village Sudan, I would say in the kind of 1920s. They hung out with men in social scenarios, obviously like in quite selective ways, and had the ability to be idiosyncratic. So they had the ability to be kind of characters in their own right. And then post-colonialism and independence and the sort of rise of bourgeois classes, which I would count my mother amongst, who had an education, university education, then began to adopt kind of Western dress and Western definitions of what being modern meant. And that modernity bestowed upon her more rights academically and professionally than her ancestors, but severely limited her socially in a kind of quite Victorian way. So the way she would dress, the way she could act in public, the way she could kind of have the freedom to express her idiosyncrasy and her character became severely curtailed. And then that extended to her children as well. So the sort of broad point I'm trying to make here is that the freedom that one thinks about does not necessarily correspond to the rights that you have, right? So my mother was ostensibly more free than her parent generation, but in other ways was much more restricted. I am ostensibly more free, having managed to relocate to the West, but actually I'm severely limited in my capacity to have a large network of family and women to help me with childcare, child rearing, plug the gaps, and et cetera, in the absence of a state that does that, that then enables me to go and practice my nominal rights that exist out there in the world. And so it's this kind of constant navigation of the different rights and how they don't necessarily correlate to freedom, but because of like economic constraints, etc. You don't have to choose because neither are perfect, but they should inform each other, and that we should think more in terms of what is the purpose of feminism, as opposed to these are just kind of tick boxes that we need to, these are boxes that we just need to tick, because the outcome can sometimes be quite surprising. And there's lots of frustration. I'm speaking from the UK, so I can speak about the UK. There is lots of frustration by working women in the UK about childcare, how expensive it is, how it's not subsidized by the state enough, how it severely compromises women's careers. But this is a modern culture in which these women have no other women around that are unemployed, retired, half employed, etc., which is something that my parents' generation had, and therefore had very seamless, very easy careers that they did not consider to be a sort of a novelty at all. So I think that those two things should kind of be in conversation with each other, as opposed to judge each other for being inferior or inadequate.
That's fascinating. I mean, I think it seems to affirm your view that there can be no kind of linear movement here in this particular trajectory of feminism. I would sort of add to that and say that maybe it's impossible to write a universal or global history of feminism. There can only be global histories of feminism, which fortunately manages to be the right title for this webinar. Because again, you know, saying history again would be imposing a particular dominant Western model of freedom or the pursuit of freedom. The social freedoms, actually, that also reminds me, I mean, there's so many instances of this in India, in the Indian subcontinent. I remember going nearly three decades ago to meet Arundhati Roy's mother in Kerala, and she informed me about a local movement. I looked it up later on. There was a local movement by women, and it was literally called, I think, the bare-breasted movement, because women went around bare-breasted in that part of the world. And the British tried to crack down on that. And there was a movement against British colonialists that, you know, we want this particular social freedom. Likewise, in Sri Lanka, there was a movement, a very strong political movement by women against the British, who were trying to crack down on polyandry and the right of women to kick out husbands whenever they wanted to, or to choose partners, you know, whenever they wanted to. So there was, you know, clearly with the arrival of colonialism, with the arrival of colonial capitalism in particular, there was an attempt to discipline women and to turn them into, you know, productive workers. And for that, it was important to bring them into, you know, this particular model of the monogamous couple, the nuclear family. And I think, you know, we kind of disregard this particular aspect, which you just highlighted, Nesrine, this, you know, the fact that there were certain freedoms available, certain social freedoms available, which then became constrained or curtailed because, you know, women are required for a different purpose. They were required to be sometimes, you know, also assistants to men. I mean, there's this phenomenon of, you know, very important women leaders in the subcontinent in particular, you know, which was, I think Sri Lanka was the first country to have a elected female prime minister. And then, of course, you know, India followed, Pakistan, Bangladesh, all of them have at some point have had female feminists, but it was, you know, I think it was under particular conditions, under, you know, certain kind of elite social, under the circumstances of elite social mobility that allowed many of these women to, you know, reach these positions, which in large parts of the West are still closed. I mean, United States actually is a particular example. Lijia, you want to say something?
Yeah, I want to make the point that the women in non-Western cultures, I think, often have to struggle harder. They have to fight against sexism, of course, and or sometimes class, sometimes caste, in case in India, religion, and sometimes certain ideology. For example, in, you know, China, for centuries, China has been dominated by Confucianism, which regards women as inferior. I think in even today, this patriarchal culture still exists, still hinders gender equality. So just a few days ago, I wrote a piece for the FT about the low female political participation. You know, we just had a National People's Congress. National People's Congress is a kind of parliament of some sort. So so only 26% of the female delegates only accounted for about 26% of the whole 3,000 delegates. So in another word, women not holding up half the sky, so only 26% of the sky. I think the reason is because of the political structure and because of the patriarchal culture. The political structure is kind of a top down. You know, they select men. They often men get selected, and women also being given a kind of a less important jobs like a family planning, culture. Men were in charge of politics and economy and so on. So, and also if you just, there are just simply not enough women in the high place. So I talk about the National People's Congress. So further step is the Politburo, with 25 members. So there's only one woman. If you go to the standing committee, it's just a boys club. So that's, I think it's this, under this kind of political structure, it's quite difficult to kind of realize gender equality.
But do you think, I mean, do you think even if women were to hold, or more women were to hold leadership positions in China, they were to populate, you know, more seats on the Politburo, for instance, would that in any significant way be a significant blow for women's rights in general in China? Or would that be, as we've seen in places like India or Pakistan or Sri Lanka, that I think women in positions of power don't actually help the advancement of, you know, women's rights for a vast majority of the population? Do you think there's still that danger there, that, you know, putting women in leadership positions leaves unaddressed
I understand, for example, in Bangladesh, there's a female leader does not mean women's position improved greatly. But I think without enough women in the position, that's not good for women, especially now. Now China wants to encourage women to have produce more children, but they have should produce policies that are favorable to women. And with men in charge, we imagine it'd be harder for them to do so. So, and also not just the government, I think they should allow NGOs and the different players to take part. But unfortunately, the government, you know, the Chinese government is obsessed with maintaining stability, and they are frightened of feminists. And in fact, another interesting twist is now the government tried to discredit feminist and feminist movement. They call that feminist being influenced by, corrupted by hostile Western power.
Interesting. Well, actually, I mean, Nesrine, doesn't that remind you of the kind of challenge many people face in places like, I mean, I can think of many countries in Asia and Africa where to call yourself a feminist is to expose yourself to attack from various nativist fundamentalist movements who accuse you of being agents of imperialism. I mean, that's certainly the case in India.
Yeah, and I'm talking about that's why the government are trying to kind of connect feminists with Western influence. And those, some feminists got attacked, and particularly by those ultra-nationalist youth. That's a really, really unfortunate. And I think the government trying to using nationalism as a tool whenever they fit.
Yeah, it's quite a similar story. I've used particularly the example of Egypt. I think something that people find quite surprising when it comes to women's rights or demands for women's rights, that in a conservative culture, is that most of the time that attempt to smear them as agents of imperialism or corrupting Western influences tends to be quite astroturfed. So it doesn't come from the grassroots. It actually doesn't come from the people around them, especially when these movements are quite indigenous and local. It comes from the top down. It comes from the government, because in authoritarian scenarios, of which many governments in the Middle East and North Africa are, to varying degrees, any movement, even something that could be something quite mild, that questions or aims to change a kind of sterile, top-down, imposed status quo, is seen as threatening to the entire political establishment. And that's why you get these really kind of crazy stories about girls on TikTok being arrested under counterterrorism or espionage rules and thrown in jail in places like Egypt. And there's all sorts of arbitrary public order laws that are applied to women, but they're also applied across the board. They're applied to entertainers, to poets, to anybody that has a slightly different definition of what the acceptable public face or popular culture of a place is, because it's so tightly controlled, which is depressing because it means that it's very difficult for any of these questions to be raised and given airing and discussed openly. But it also is, in a different way, quite heartening, because you don't know what it looks like yet. You actually, you know, in many places, you actually don't know what the reception would be if such a movement of questioning were allowed to flourish. And again, it is non-linear. You know, again, there have been situations, particularly pre-Arab Spring, where there was so much space for sort of quite counterintuitive flourishings of women's rights in certain parts of the Arab world. And one could argue the reason the Arab Spring happened in the first place is people kind of took their eye off the ball and let so many of these disparate influences grow, which then created a political movement and a political demand for change. And so the lesson of the Arab Spring was that you have to patrol all borders in the public space for you to maintain your hold. That was the lesson that kind of authoritarians took away from the Arab Spring. So there are histories of feminism. I'm thinking particularly of Noëlla Saadawi, who made these connections and saw that the oppression of women through religion was actually more about politics and maintaining control than it was about genuine piety and commitment to religious values. And the way that that was inflicted upon women was usually upon the women kind of at the lower rungs of society, working class, farming women, women in jail. But there's not been the space to have like a bigger conversation about that, because it immediately trespasses onto a very fragile political space that dictators, even though they're strong men, are actually very weak, and so need to police them quite carefully all the time.
Fascinating. We have only 9 minutes remaining. A couple of questions. First one, how's the issue of violence treated in non-Western feminist narratives? Does it seem like Western feminism is portrayed separately from violence, but non-Western feminism is often associated with it in Western narratives? Lijia, would you like to have a go?
Oh, I haven't thought about that. I regretted not to mention ending my talk with the negative. So I go just one. Well, can I just go back to the China's case? I think there's a crackdown, but I don't think a feminism movement is going to die out completely, because as women are better educated, they are more technical savvy, they're more aware of the international norm. They were finding creative ways to continue the fight. Sorry, that is the back, not to the question. Sorry, Nesrine, could I pass that question to you?
Yeah, I'm going to answer a slightly different question, which is sort of the cheeky prerogative of the panelists that where the questioner cannot come back, which is that the issue of violence is very interesting because it is very clarifying in how different ways of behavior vis-a-vis women's rights are seen in ways that are entirely cultured, right? So something like 35% of homicides in the US of women are committed by intimate partners. Mm. And a kind of similar number as in the UK. And the equivalent of that, actually, I'm not sure about the UK, so I'll just put a pin on that. And about 17% of male homicides is by intimate partners. So it's about half. The way this would be framed from where I'm from is that it's honor killings. And that these are kind of family-based honor episodes of violence that are linked to religion, they're linked to backward tribal cultures. There's a very clear understanding of underage marriage, marital rape and honor killings that is associated entirely with the culture, whereas we don't really have that when it comes to that kind of analysis. When it comes to violence against women in the West, it's just treated as a problem, like why are men violent and how can we solve that, but it's not pathologized. And the argument would be it needs to be pathologized a little bit, actually, because it will tell you something deeper and more profound. But at the same time, it needs to be depathologized in other areas, because it's clearly a bias that makes us more comfortable seeing violence in that way in other cultures and not in our own.
So in other words, I mean, I think the pathology of modernity, or capitalist modernity to be more precise, gets a kind of pass. But any kind of violence that happens within a pre-modern or a modernizing or semi-modern context is described as a, you know, serious aberration within that particular culture, or stigmatized with words like honor killings. I mean, you know, which again, the sort of going back to our earlier discussion, you know, a great sort of disparity in interpreting both the advance and the failures of, you know, the struggle to gain women's rights, is that we don't take into account these sort of, you know, this very complex picture of, as you said, freedoms not corresponding with rights, because we have this bias or prejudice. We are all working with this particular prejudice that the journey towards capitalist modernity is the ideal journey, and that's something we should all undertake, and not really take into account the various problems that can arise in the process, including, you know, the big problem of domestic violence, which happens in, you know, in again, you know, in contexts very directly shaped, created by capitalist economic structures. One more question, or it's actually more of a comment. The history of feminism in Iran old Persian Empire has some overlaps and many distinctions from the regions discussed today. It is also very different from Arab and other Islamic countries. Has that ever been academically studied or discussed in academic forums? I don't know. Do you know, Nesrine? It must have
No,
been.
I'm sure it has. I just can't come off the top of my head with the reference, but it is an interesting observation. And one thing that's particularly interesting about Iran is that broadly, actually not just when it comes to women's rights, but broadly, the way kind of Iranian culture assimilated Islam, ironically, because now it's seen as this kind of, you know, Ayatollah governed dark age of Islam was one of the more liberal and diverse interpretations of Islam. So in art, you have all these controversies about depictions of the prophet and fatwa, again talking about non-linear rights and freedoms, the sort of pop modern attitudes about depictions of the prophet and the sanctity of Islamic iconography is refuted by the fact that only a few hundred years ago in Persian art, there were very many depictions of the prophet and nobody made a fuss about it whatsoever. Because it existed in a certain context, there wasn't a politicization of it, and there wasn't a kind of competition with other cultures about the supremacy of Islam and its sanctity, etc. So it is an interesting conversation, like how cultures that were very enlightened in certain ways then change because they enter into this kind of political marketplace in which religion, women's rights, ideology all become recruited in a campaign that is directed at that kind of competition for a status, as opposed to allowed to just flourish organically.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think we can say with a high degree of confidence that a lot of rights available to women had to be abandoned in the race to become modern competitive nation states in so many contexts. You know, so there are traditions within India. Of course, you know, we have a very long tradition of you know, female deities, you know, symbolizing a certain kind of, you know, feminine power. Which, you know, just tells you that there was a different kind of conceptualization, different kind of configuration that existed in the classical past. And I think, you know, people invoke them today in order to boast that we had this particular tradition. But at the same time, the people who are invoking them, the so-called Hindu nationalists, are very much parts and products and, you know, perpetrators of a patriarchal system. So you have that particular historical irony as well, you know, that you're constantly invoking this tradition of, you know, greater women's rights, but at the same time, what you really want is women to, you know, be essentially workers for the new Hindu nation coming into being. But anyway, thank you both for really a wonderfully stimulating conversation, and thank you. You know, everyone who joined us. We have a third webinar coming up on the 19th of March, and we'll be discussing the histories of fascism with Veronica Gago, Kohei Saito, and Naomi Klein. And I hope you can join us then. Thanks again, everyone, and see you very
Thank you
soon.
for having me.